Today I'm going to share the findings from our research on using biopesticides to control Lubbock mealybug. Lubbock mealybug was first found causing damage to citrus in 2019. Since then, we have learned a lot about this pest, both here in Florida and from our colleagues in other countries who have dealt with managing it for much longer. This pest is known to cause economic damage to citrus in regions where it exists. This includes damage to fruit, leaves, and stems, fruit drop, and even the death of young trees. Because this pest exists in different regions, it has several common names, including spherical mealybug, cotton mealybug, hibiscus mealybug, and Lubbock mealybug. Lubbock mealybug is an introduced pest with origins in the Asiatic region. This pest can reach economically damaging levels due to its high reproductive capacity and a toxin associated with its feeding. Feeding damage will result in fruit that are not marketable for fresh fruit markets, but may be acceptable as juice fruit, as the quality of fruit is similar to undamaged fruit. The challenge is minimizing feeding damage, such that 1, fruit are able to stay on the tree and mature, and 2, the calluses formed as a result of feeding do not make the fruit too misshaped to go through the juicing process. Research from the Middle East and South Africa in previous decades have established how damaging this pest can become if not managed. In one report, heavily infested groves had to be burned to protect other groves from infestation. To date, Lubbock mealybug has been documented in 12 counties, mostly on citrus. This pest has a large potential host range, which has been described in various other regions of the world. Since its initial finding in Florida in 2009, it has been collected from 21 hosts, including citrus, where it has been able to cause quite a bit of damage in fields where it has infested. Fruit damage can range from complete loss to severe or mild rind damage. We think that the level of damage is dependent on when fruit are infested by the mealybugs. Obviously, none of the fruit pictured here are suitable for fresh market sales. However, fruit that are able to stay on the tree and ripen, despite their damage, may be suitable for use in juice markets. Damage to leaves can be an early indicator that you have mealybug infestation. Leaves will curl and occasionally exhibit the sclerotic veins as shown in the image on the top right. Sooty mold development is also a sign that you should look and see who's producing the honeydew that the mold is growing on. Several scales and aphids can also cause this, so checking to see who your culprit is will enable you to make management decisions. Heavy feeding pressure will lead to branches dying and leaving behind an appearance of being sucked dry. Unfortunately, this feeding damage can also lead to severe developmental setbacks and even death of young trees. In this photo is a tree that was part of a reset under individual protective covers. This grower lost about 80% of the planting from Lubbock mealybug damage. Studies on this pest in other countries showed that it could cause 50% or greater crop loss if not controlled. Of course, the amount of loss will depend on the infestation levels, and as I mentioned previously, likely when in the development of the fruit or tree infestation occurs. As we relearn how to grow citrus and protect it from psyllids, new tools like the individual protective covers, or IPCs, have become a popular tool for preventing their access. Unfortunately, though, these covers also make a great place for small pests like Lubbock mealybug to enter, establish, and cause damage, all while being largely protected from predators and potentially insecticide applications once the tree canopy becomes dense inside the bags. One question we get frequently is how do they get in? Crawlers of this pest are very small and likely easily transported on the wind. We have also seen them carried by ants and have found them on IPCs after they've been removed, so they could likely be moved on the bags if they are reused without sanitation. Okay, so how do we prevent these infestations or clean them up? This is an active area of research in our group. With regards to insecticides, we know that our handgun sprayer can penetrate the bags, but are unsure about air blast sprayers and plan to test this summer. We didn't see good results when a grower tested drenches as a cleanup for us, but perhaps they might work as a preventative. Again, something we'll be testing later in the season. If we have to open bags, spray, and close bags again, there may be issues with worker safety contacting materials under the re-entry interval. Another option is to keep the bottoms open. That might allow predators in, which could help manage the pests, but that's tricky in windy areas. In our research planting in Lake Placid this past year, we consistently had bags being blown up and over our trees while remaining zip-tied to the post, so we had to close our bottoms. In thinking about what management options may work well with IPCs, we thought that biopesticides may be a good fit, since they would likely not degrade or wash off as quickly under the bags as in an open field setting. If we are correct, then growers could potentially get several weeks of control from one application and not need to treat as frequently as they might with many conventional products whose field longevity is known to be fairly short. First, we ran a laboratory screening to test which materials would work well on the pests under optimal conditions. We looked at three entomopathogenic fungi, or EPFs, that are Bovaria bastiana products, which are Botanigard ES, Bottega, and Botanigard Max. Botanigard ES and Bottega are very similar products, and Botanigard Max has an addition of a pyrethrin to the entomopathogenic fungus. PFR 97 is another EPF derived from another fungus that is often quite useful against other mealybug species. Grandivo is a biopesticide known to be effective on many mealybug species. And Centaur, or bupropion, is an insect growth regulator, also known to be quite effective on several mealybug species. We used these laboratory data to decide which materials were likely the most efficacious for Leveck mealybug and took them into a grove setting to test further. In the fall of 2020, my student David Olaby tested three products and a combination of those products using a semi-field bioassay. We used Botanigard ES, remember that this and Bottega perform similarly, Botanigard Max, Centaur, and the combination of Botanigard ES and Centaur. We also concluded a water control and adjuvant controls. Working with the CRAFT program through CREF, we located growers using IPCs that allowed us to treat trees, remove leaves weekly, and return those leaves to the lab to challenge with mealybugs. This test enabled us to get leaves containing field-aged EPS, or the IGR, from under the bags to then challenge in the lab without infesting their trees. This is the weekly mortality data from one of our sites for each of these materials. There's a lot going on in this graph, so I'm going to orient you a little bit to how this is all set up. So we looked at the mortality by week. So week zero here is the days that trees were treated. We allowed the trees to dry, collected leaves, and closed bags. For this comparison, we compared four test materials or combinations of materials, as you can see in the top right, Centaur, which is the insect growth regulator, or IGR, Botanigard Max, the entomopathogenic fungi with pyrethrin added, a combination of Botanigard ES and Centaur, so this is an EPF and an IGR, and the EPF alone as Botanigard ES. We also included water in two adjuvants, SUF oil and 435 oil as controls. SUF oil is recommended for use with the EPF products, and we generally like to use 435 oil with our IGR, so we wanted to keep that material in the mix. In the lab, we challenged the Leveck mealybug nymphs to determine mortality, shown here as the proportion dead each week. This line is the 50% mark to help visualize mortality. As you can see, the entomopathogenic fungus in combination with the insect growth regulator has the highest mortality rate, though with a good deal of variance, through week three. This isn't really surprising since the IGR impedes development of nymphs, which would allow the entomopathogenic fungus more time to penetrate the insect's cuticle and kill it. As a reference, we ran a short test of malathion under IPCs this spring at another location. Malathion generally degrades within a few days after application, but in the IPCs, we had about 2 weeks of efficacy, so you can get materials like malathion to last a bit longer in the reduced UV environments of the IPCs as well. So are entomopathogenic fungi a good option for control in IPCs? Maybe. As I mentioned in the last slide, the EPF plus IGR combination looks really promising, and it appears to have good post-application efficacy for at least 3 weeks, which is slightly longer than malathion. But we have to consider cost here. To ensure thorough coverage of the trees, we open bags to treat and close them after the material is dried. which will amount to quite an investment in labor. The cost of the EPFs is generally higher than many commonly used insecticides. It may be a wash in terms of cost versus duration of efficacy, but we'll run a larger trial this summer with IPCs and more insecticides so we can make this decision with more data. So there's some things to consider when deciding to use a biopesticide versus a conventional material. We know that insecticides alone are unlikely to provide complete control. We also know that topical materials will kill what they contact with minimal residual efficacy. This is exemplified by the image on this slide. The topical insecticide killed a lot of the cluster of mealybugs that it came into contact with, but without any residual or systemic activity, these nymphs were unharmed and able to continue their development under the dried out, waxy, dead bodies of other mealybugs. We've seen that systemic materials seem to work well on the feeding life stages, but will miss any of the non-feeding life stages like crawlers and eggs. We also know from other research that biopesticides are generally soft on predators, allowing them to establish and work towards helping control this pest. And they may be worthwhile because if spores can persist for several weeks, they can be efficient in reducing populations of mealybugs. In thinking about implementing biopesticides practically, we can think about using them early in the season to prevent population buildup. Spring temperatures are cool enough to allow spores to remain viable in bags, and we don't expect wash-off to be a huge concern as in open fields. The entomopathogenic fungi are OMRI-listed, so they can be used for organic production. In protected areas like IPCs and greenhouses or screenhouses, where the likelihood of wash-off can be reduced and UV degradation would be less than in open fields, these could easily be implemented. In general, though, we do not anticipate that these would be great cleanup materials for heavy infestations. Those will likely require a targeted program incorporating several modes of action to take care of. I'd like to thank my staff, students, collaborators, and industry partners in making this research happen in this crazy year. And of course, Citrus Research and Development Foundation for funding this research, and the growers who allowed us to work on their fields. While I'm not able to join you all today, I am available for questions, preferably via email. So if you have any questions from today's presentation or any questions about Leavitt mealybug in general, please shoot me an email and I will get back to you as soon as possible. Thank you for listening.